Bart, let's continue our discussion on charter change. We're now joined by former NEDA Secretary Ernesto Pernia. Professor Pernia, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. It's good to see you after seeing you at my lecture last November.
I feel the same way, sir. So after being the chairperson, the secretary of NEDA, and where we are today, do you believe that some aspects of the charter should be opened or amended?
Not necessary. You know, the provisions for economic investments coming in can be done without without tinkering with the Constitution. For example, we have three provisions already that were crafted during Duterte's time, during our time: Public Service Act, Foreign Investment Act, and Retail Trade Liberalization Act. And they have not even made a headway yet. We have not made a headway in any of those. Why don't we just focus on those three, for example, instead of tinkering with the Constitution? We are wasting time. And also, if we do a cha-cha, it's going to be expensive. Where do we get the money? We have a lot of deficit, something like 14 trillion deficit. Mm-hmm. So it's really a bad thinking or bad decision on the part of Congress and the Senate, or maybe okay, Congress than the Senate.
Let's talk about the Public Service Act. I know the Public Service Act, part of the amendments was actually moving telecom and railway from utilities to services, correct?
That's correct.
Uh-oh. And that's, if you move telecom and railway to services, you can actually have you can have them 100% foreign owned. The problem is there are two petitions before the Supreme Court questioning the legality of that law, saying that you cannot amend something as foundational as that. You can't just make a law to amend something as clear in the Constitution as that. So ang sinasabi nila, kaya nga walang foreign direct investment, kasi ba't ka mag-i-invest doon? Eh kung pending yun sa Supreme Court.
I don't know. I don't think former Chief Justice Secretary Carpio said so. I think he did not mention that there's a need for the Supreme Court to adjust or to allow changes in the Public Service Act.
No, what I'm asking is the petitions before the Supreme Court, the fact that there are petitions seeking clarity, doesn't this affect foreign direct investments? Kaya ang sinasabi ng ilan, dapat nga baguhin ang Constitution mismo para malinaw.
No, the three provisions I mentioned, they can be done by Congress and the Senate without having to tinker with the Constitution.
Yes, that's your opinion. But yes, some believe it's not.
Well, maybe we should ask Supreme Court Justice Carpio again about
that. All right, so let's move forward. You were with NEDA. You have seen, you've been in government, you've seen the challenges. Why is it? Why is it that Indonesia and Vietnam are drawing most of the foreign direct investments? What's the real problem? What did you see?
You know, Vietnam, Indonesia, Thailand, you will notice that there is not too much debate and discussion on issues. They just have meetings and then they agree. And you know, all of and they're able to withdraw investments that way. We have too many there are too many debates and too many time use you know spent on debating you know issues and therefore we are lagging behind in terms of getting foreign direct investment. The latest foreign direct investment we had, I think last year, was only about $3 billion. $3 billion. And the highest we had was about $10 billion during the time of Duterte, during our time, 10 to 11 billion. So it's really saddening that we are getting a measly amount of foreign direct investments compared with our ASEAN neighbors.
Okay, but I wanted to tell you, when you quote $10 billion, during the time of former President Duterte, part of it was also POGO. Yes.
It's possible. Yes.
So I feel that's not the best example, right? Because at the end of the day, at the end of his term, there was a whole decision to remove POGO. So that's why we saw the housing sector, the rental sector, offices, they all went down. But POGO is not the kind of investment you want to see in the country.
You're right. Yeah, we don't want to see POGO. But if POGO would have probably of the 10 billion, probably what, 10%? Or 20% of the 10 billion could be accounted for by POGO. So still, so you're talking about 8 billion, which is pretty high at that time.
Okay. So what is it then? What challenges is the Philippines facing, considering the president today is even, he's more palatable to the Western world, right? So if here's Duterte, you're saying, okay, take out POGO, it's 8 billion. But this is a president who's actually, he's more liked in the Western world. He's more business friendly. His whole personality, the whole campaign, the whole foreign policy of this government. So why don't we have it?
We are told that he has traveled 19 times, right? 19 times since he assumed office. And we would have expected, a surge of foreign direct investments that would follow his trips to these different destinations. But we are not seeing any of those yet. I think at the most, there was mention of about 700 billion likely to come, 700 billion likely to come pesos, not dollars, pesos because of his recent trips.
But my question is, what are the inherent problems in the Philippines for foreign direct investors? Because, for example, in Vietnam and Indonesia, I checked, and even Thailand and Vietnam, foreigners also can't own land. In manufacturing in the Philippines, you can be 100% foreign owned. Power in the Philippines, you can be 100% foreign owned. So why aren't they coming to us?
Well, there's been mention a couple of times that it's because of red tape, corruption, and ease of doing business.
But did you experience this yourself? Did you see this when you were NEDA secretary?
I wasn't able to compare this thing during our time with you know, as far as restrictions are concerned, or the inhibitions of foreigners. But I think this thing about corruption, red tape, and ease of doing business, they are very important items to consider that we have not really gotten over.
Mm-mm. Okay, Professor, so what do you see as the real intention of reviewing the charter? How do you define this?
Well, I'm not in favor of tinkering with the charter, because as Winnie Monsod said earlier, there are really many other things that we need to do rather than tinkering with the charter, with the constitution. So, and I think that is also what former Supreme Court Justice Carpio said, that we just need to change certain things that can be done without touching the constitution or the charter of the constitution.
Okay, I wanted to ask you, because off camera you said this was a hoax. Do you still stand by that? Is it a hoax?
I really meant that it's a hoax in terms of it's a way of trying to get more mileage for politicians, for congressmen and senators, more mileage in terms of term limits and other things that have to do with their presence in the Senate and Congress.
Okay, and I think last words, was it ever in the Philippine Development Plan that charter change was a factor in improving the country's economic state?
I have been through a couple of Philippine Development Plan, and we did not touch the charter. We did not touch the constitution. We just mentioned, for example, the three items that have been passed in Congress: the Public Service Act, Foreign Investment Act, and the Retail Trade Liberalization Act.
Mm. All right. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, former NEDA Secretary Ernesto Pernia. Thank you, sir. Be well. Thank you.
Thank you too, Ma'am Karen.